So, hello everybody. This is the second talk in my mini series on property-based testing. And as Tim has said a month ago, I have given an introduction and some examples of PBT. And today I want to talk about shrinkers. And shrinkers are the part of testing libraries that will try to simplify your random fading input to a minimal example that still fails the test. And it turns out there is more than one way to implement shrinkers. And I quite like the way that almost nobody does implement shrinkers, because it solves some problems that everybody else has. And I want to evangelize it a bit. It might solve some of our issues in day-to-day usage of Scala check, et cetera. So just to quickly recap the previous talk and the absolute basics of what I will be talking about. Again, property-based tests will generate random inputs for your tests. And then if they find a fading value, they will try to shrink it before giving it to you. So for example, I will write a test saying that any integer n will be less than 100, which is obviously wrong. And the test runner will run the test with a bunch of random integers. And eventually it will find something big like 5,023,000. And before giving it to me, it will shrink it down, hopefully manage to shrink it down to 100, which is the smallest integer that fails. And only then will it say 100 fails the test. And it's really useful because as soon as you start generating anything remotely complex, like lists of operations or compound data structures or recursive data structures, there's a bunch of stuff in the original fading value that isn't related to the failure at all, right? And so it's nice to be able to get, for example, 7 operations, each of which is absolutely essential for the debug to surface, rather than a list of 100 values. So that's PBT and shrinking from high level. Now let's talk about details. So it all started with quick check, originally written in Haskell, and initially quick check didn't have shrinking at all. The idea of minimizing the fading input to give something more useful to you is optional, right? PBT can exist without it. It is just so useful that nowadays everybody does it. So if you go spelunking into the initial implementations, you can see the original paper and source code. They don't say anything about shrinking at all. And all the ports of the library around the time, they don't do shrinking either. But then somehow between 2000 and 2006, somebody got the idea that we could do, you know, we could shrink the counter examples to make them easier to understand. And I couldn't find the history of it. Couldn't find any papers or commits or changelogs. But if you look up the first commit in the current Haskell QuickCheck Git repository, which goes back to 2006, where the first commit is an import from CVS, so there's additional history, but I just couldn't find it. They already do have shrinking, right? It's that function at the bottom. Shrink goes from A to a list of A's. So that's how you do it. You take the generated value that fails the test, and you think of a bunch of potentially simpler values to run the test with. And so for an integer, we might try to divide it by 2, subtract 1 from it, replace it with 0. If the number is negative, we could try to make it positive, and so on. For a list, we might remove some values from the list, or we might shrink the values inside. And again, the test runner will pick these proposed simpler values, and it will use them. And if suddenly the test passes, then that isn't a valid simplification, right? We have made the problem go away. So we have to retrace our steps and try something else. But if it does still fail, then great. We have made an improvement, found a simpler value, and moved towards some local minimum. So the shrink loop will just throw a bunch of ideas on the wall and see what sticks, and it will repeat until none of the values proposed by the shrink function fail the test anymore. And then we give the final value to the user. Now we can see that we need an implementation of these shrink functions for all of our types, right? And this is mostly fine. The libraries can expose a default way to do shrinking for all the primitives, but there's an issue. So if we shrink purely based on the final value with no knowledge of how we got there, how we generated it, shrinking can't really guarantee all the invariants the generators give us. And this is an issue that, for example, Scala check has right now, and that many of you doubtless have experienced already. Let's say you generate integers that are multiples of hundreds, right? So you first generate arbitrary integer, and then you multiply it. You map the times 100 function over it. And so the generator will always give you nice rounded numbers, but the default integer shrinker has no idea that you did map. And so if you go through that example, we'll create a test saying that all multiples of 100 are less than 321 and see what happens. The integer generator will pick 9, so far so good, multiply it by 100, and we run the test. The test says false. That's a failure. 900 is not less than 321. All right, so let's give that counter example to the shrinker, right? And the shrinker will take 900 and it will try things like, again, 900 divided by 2, 900 minus 1, and so on. And those do fail the test, sure, but they are not the integers you wanted to test. Can you see? 450 is not something that the generator would produce. And so we are now testing values we didn't want to test. And so it walks through all these weird non-multiples, even though those are irrelevant to your test. And it does eventually end up at the number 321, which is the smallest integer that fails the test. It reports that number to you, and you look at the value and you say to yourself, what the heck, I didn't generate these. How did you come up with 321? And so this initial implementation where we always use the default shrinker for the type isn't ideal. We can make an improvement though. Let's try a second iteration. So there's this classic trick of building a lazy tree of possible shrink values instead of a list and manipulating the whole tree at once with functions like map. And so now we essentially have to bundle generators and shrinkers together. The Elm community does this and calls these fuzzers, so that's what I'm gonna call them, but it's essentially just a combination of a generator and shrinker at the same time. And so now we can build our combinator library around fuzzers instead of generators and shrinkers separately, and it will build them both at the same up. It will build them both up at the same time. We will only be able to use them together. And so if we map the generated values, we also map the shrunk values. And so the map function just delegates to the lazy tree. There's a bunch of closures floating around waiting for the moment you will call them. And so we can remember to do the work without actually doing the work right now. And the tree for the integer fuzzer might look like this. You can see that 3 will simplify to 2, 2 will simplify to 1, 1 will simplify to 0, and so on, right? And when you map it, it will simply run the map function over all these nodes. So now we will not get any values that our generator wouldn't produce, right? There is no 499, there is no 450, and so on. And so when we run our toy example again, we will still fail on 900, nothing changes there. But now our shrinker will only give us sensible values that could have been generated by the generator alone. And so the result after all that shrinking is still in the domain of the generator, still in the domain of the test. It is still something we would have expected. And so all is well. Well, not all as well. We now have a different issue. Consider this example. You have the generator that uses the almighty monadic bind. I will call it end-gen because, again, that's what the Elm community calls it, but it's bind, right? And so in our test, again, purposefully nonsensical test so that we fail and see the shrinking in action, we generate a string of random length, right? We do it by generating integer for the length and then generating a string of that specific length. And then in the test, we expect the string to be empty, which mostly will not be true because most strings aren't empty. And remember, now we are building the shrinkers on the side at the same time, right? We always will run map on shrinkers if we run it on generators and so on. But not even that can save us from, I guess, the raw power of monadic bind, and we get into a dead end. Let's see this play out. So the generator picks the number 3, the string of length generator takes that and generates a random string of 3 characters. So let's say ABC. The test takes that and looks at the string and fails. It's not empty. You promised it will always be empty, and it's not. So we go to the shrinking phase. And again, I will not show that, you know, the shrinker is really many shrinkers inside, but anyways, the whole compound shrinker runs and it gives you a string with 3 spaces. And the next time we run the test, it will give you a string with 5 spaces. And in the next with 55. What's going on? Why is it shrinking the characters in the string, but not the length of the string? Why didn't we get a string with just 1 space, right? This is the proper minimal example. And it turns out there is no way, at least as we currently know, there's no way to implement monad laws over those lazy trees in a way that will shrink both the first and the second part, right? That will shrink the length and the string afterwards. So basically when implementing join, you can think about it as like concatenation, to collapse a tree of trees of values back into just tree of values. You can choose between 2 ways, but you can't have both at the same time. So in the context of our example, we can either shrink the length or we can shrink the string inside, but not both. Or we can switch them around, but we can't have both. And this limitation is the reason that some of these tools, rather than giving you a non-optimal shrinker whenever you use these like monadic bind functions, it will rather disable shrinking and let you specify one yourself manually, tailored to your data structure. And there are a few blog posts and GitHub issues and tickets on the internet about this. As the middle screenshot says, it's a long-standing hard problem. So if you by any chance solve it, you will make many library authors happy. But so far we don't really know of a solution. And now for the grand finale, we are now getting to my main point, which is we can fix this. We can sidestep this whole issue. There's an approach that doesn't suffer from any of the problems I spent the last, 15 minutes talking about. In fact, it doesn't need you to care about shrinkers at all. You never have to manually write a shrinker again. And this new approach was spearheaded by Hypothesis, the Python library, and a few libraries in other languages have adopted it as well, but it's generally not a very well-known approach. A bit of humble brag, I have implemented it for Elm and it works really nicely. And so I'm really excited about it. So what is it about? Essentially, all you need is a layer of indirection. Here's the new algorithm. Let's walk through these changes. So instead of shrinking the value itself, as the two previous approaches did, we shrink the PRNG history. this is the new interaction, and I will explain it shortly. And you can see that the shrink group doesn't go straight to the test because we don't have a shrunk value now. It goes back to the generator. We are essentially seeding the generator to give us a simpler value. And because the generator with whatever maps and filters and binds is running from scratch inside the shrink loop, we now have all the guarantees that the initially generated value had, right? There's now no difference between values from the generator and values from the shrinker, because all values come from the generator now. And because we are shrinking the underlying PRNG history and not the values themselves, this is kind of immune to the monadic bind blindness. That was the second problem, right? If you run the string of random length is empty test from before in the hypothesis or another tool that uses this approach, you will get a properly shrunk string with one space every time. And it shrinks both the length and the characters afterwards. All right, so let's explain what the PRNG history is. Internally, all the generators and combinators are built out of one primitive generator, which is unsigned integer, like 0 to n, right? You can say the end of that interval. And this special primitive generator, it actually calls the standard library PRNG, and it knows the seed for it, and it tracks all that. And whenever it takes a number from the PRNG, it remembers it into a list, or I don't know, is it a stack or a queue? Can't remember, but it just remembers it into a list. And all the other generators draw these integers and somehow convert them into different data types. So characters are easy, right? It's just like the ASCII code or the Unicode code for that. So space would be 32 and so on. Floats would take that integer and interpret it, its bits according to the float spec, i.e. 754, right? So some bits are the exponent, some bits are mantissa, there's a sign bit, whatever. Doubles would take two such integers and combine them together. Boolean would be just zero is false, one is true, and so on. And our PRNG history is a list of those integers that we took from the real PRNG, let's say. And so before we find a failure and start shrinking, we are creating that list. As you can see here on the example from before. So the generator will later provide both the generated value, which is the string, and the PRNG history that can be used to replay the generation, right? And that's these yellow boxes here. And so you can kind of see how it steps through that. So it starts with empty history because it didn't draw any integer from the PRNG yet. The integer generator picks a number, remembers it. And then the string of length generator does have some kind of loop inside, and so it will pick three integers because it picks three characters. So the first will be 97, which is A, 98, which is B, and so on. And so now we have generated a value of your type and the history that can be used to kind of replay that. And after we find a failure, we get to shrink that list. And so now, again, we are not shrinking the value. We don't know how to shrink strings. We know how to shrink the PRNG history. And we kind of specialize on that. So you can see that we try to, you know, lower this number and it does something. We try to remove some items and that also does something. And we kind of arrive at the minimal PRNG history that gives the best value. And So each time we make an attempt, each time we get a new PRNG history, we give that history back to the generator and see whether it will be able to get a value out of it. Because sometimes it can't. You can imagine promising too many values and then not delivering on that, right? So I promise three values, and then the generator will try to pick the first, the second, and then it will try to pick the third one, which doesn't work. We have run out of randomness, so to speak. So this is not a valid PRNG history for the generator. You can imagine failing even the first generator, right? Because again, it will try to pick a number and it can't. You can find PRNG histories that are okay. Generator does generate a value successfully, but it doesn't fail the test. So we don't care about those either. And as you can see on the left, it doesn't really matter when the PRNG history has more values than needed, right? Here we only consume 1 and 97. We do have more values available, but it doesn't matter much. But it's the other case where it needs more than we can give it that's problematic. And so let's revisit the flowchart one more time and focus on the arrows at the very top. And so generators work in one of two modes. Either they are truly using a random number generator and making nodes as they draw values from it, or they are using the hard-coded PRNG history and draw values out of that. And as we have seen a moment ago, not every PRNG history can be used with every generator. Generators can fail. And so that is one source of inefficiency. To be fair, this hypothesis approach will in general be a little bit slower than the quick check approach. In my measurements, somewhere around a factor of 2, but I would say the positives are worth it. And so to kind of summarize the two main points here, first, thanks to running the generator after the shrink inside the shrink loop, we have all the guarantees from the generators, right? So all the maps, filters, monadic binds, everything, we are not shrinking the values themselves anymore. And second, since our generators are based on that one building block, basically PRNG history is a list of integers all the time, we can kind of hide the shrinking implementation from the user. The user doesn't really know and can't really influence the shrinking in any way. And then the library authors can just like create more shrinking strategies if they find, okay, this doesn't shrink very well, right? So we can find more and more ways to shrink the list of integers. And again, the user doesn't care, and it shrinks even those like monadic bind histories. And I will not dive too deep into how to shrink the PRNG history, but I will give you a high level sketch or like some principles. The keyword here is short legs, and that's a word that the author of the hypothesis library invented. It's a combination of two words, short and lexicographic. So shorter is always better. And on tiebreak, we go with the lexicographic ordering. That is to say, basically an alphabetical ordering, just generalized to whatever lists, not just to strings. So a difference on position near the beginning will be more impactful than the difference near the end. And so that's kind of the golden rule that everything adheres to. The library of generators and combinators is written in such a way to play nice with this rule that the shrinker doesn't really know what generator was used or kind of in what pattern will the generator draw the values, right? And so the shrinker has made it really like known to the generators via documentation that smaller, in the short leg sense, smaller PRNG histories will be what it will try to find. And so the generators have to kind of agree to that, and generators will have to represent simpler values by those shorter PRNG strings. And I said simpler, not smaller, because simpler can mean different things. And it has to do, I guess, with human perception. It comes down to what you would prefer to see as a test counter example. With integers, you would probably prefer some number close to zero rather than close to minus infinity, and preferably positive number rather than a negative number, right? So even though the first one is technically smaller, the second one is simpler. With floats, wouldn't it be nice to get a nice human readable small fraction rather than some unreadable mass? Again, even though the first one is smaller, the second one is at least subjectively simpler. And so we can write our generators in such a way that it will play nice with the shrinker behavior. So that when it shrinks towards short legs, shorter and simpler PRNG histories, it will make the values that are generated from that, it will make them simpler according to your rules. All right, so what now? I have given you the basic rundown of the common problems that property-based testing libraries do have, and that you might have experienced already, and the usual solutions that the library authors reach for. And if I'm not mistaken, Scala check as of today doesn't really give you any guarantees on the shrunk values, and we need to enforce things with refined and so on. Other libraries do have it a little bit better. I would call them like the second generation. For example, the current version of Elm Test, the one before I made a rewrite, that one is not released yet. So the current version does use the lazy tree approach. And as I have shown, the lazy tree approach does have the problem with the monadic bind. And in Elm Test, it has actually been removed. And we were kind of thinking, should we re-add it? And if you need the power of the magnetic bind, which it does come up every now and then, you need to resort to writing your generators and shrinkers separately, right? So you can write a generator that does have the monadic bind, it does have the end-end function, but then you have to say, how will it shrink? So you have to care about it. And so it might be nicer to have, it might be nicer to have the end-end function work as you would expect and not have to care about shrinkers at all. And so it seems like this is a whack-a-mole of find and fix one problem and another comes up. And as a testing community, we are slowly stepping up the ladder and figuring out how to implement these libraries so that we solve this next problem that's in front of us. And it is my belief that the hypothesis approach with shrinking PRNG histories instead of shrinking values is the currently best known solution, in that it whacks all the moles that are currently up. It solves the problems that we currently do know about. And I'm sure there will be more of them, but this is currently, I think, the frontier of our collective wisdom. So I wanted to tell you about it. And so in closing, Andy Stanley, a pastor, in his talk Communicating for a Change, said, let people imagine what if. What if we behaved like that? What if that happened? What if we had that, right? What would the world be like? And when I learned about this solution for shrinkers, I wanted it so bad that I wrote it, and it will come into Elm Test 2.0. And I want to encourage you to dream about how nice it would be if we had it in the Scala world as well. And if you want to take a step at implementing it, I will be very happy to help you. And that's all. Thank you. Any questions?